Let's move on to generalized seizures. In a patient with generalized seizures, it's important to control the seizure, but you've probably got about 5 minutes. Remember, most pediatric seizures will stop of their own accord within 5 minutes. An EEG after the seizure is done may be useful for identifying underlying seizure syndromes. Let me give you an example. Lennox Acousto syndrome has an onset typically between 3 and 5 years of age. These patients have mixed varieties of seizure, and they may develop mental retardation and severe behavioral problems. Lennox Acousto has a very typical EEG pattern. It's not so important for a medical student or a resident, or even a fellow will probably need to know it if they're a neurology fellow, but most of us don't need to know how specifically to read EEGs, but we should be aware that there are certain patterns in them that give away certain diagnoses, and Lennox Acousto does have a typical EEG appearance. The reason why it's important to make the diagnosis of Lennox Acousto is because it is a difficult to manage disease and will require the guidance of a pediatric neurologist. Here's an example of an EEG. What you can see here is a patient who has Lennox Acousto. You can see that there are intermittent periods of independent polywave spikes lasting for roughly 1 to 8 seconds, and that is classic and emblematic of that disease. Okay, let's move on to antiepileptic drugs. We've got Dilantin or phenytoin. We've got phenobarbital, and another one we'll talk about might be ethosuximide. These are all drugs that we're going to use to place a child on all the time to help prevent them from getting recurrent seizures when their seizures are frequent. Dilantin, or phenytoin, is good for partial or generalized seizures. The problem is you need to know the serum drug levels in patients on this drug, and over time they can develop side effects. The side effect you're going to be asked about on your test is probably gingival hypertrophy. They get excessively growing gums. They also have increased body hair. Usually on the arms, you can see it very easily. And long term, they can have neurotoxic effects with actually a loss of IQ points over time. So we like to avoid the seizure drugs unless we truly need them. Phenobarbital, generally used better in children under 1 year of age. It's good for partial or generalized seizures. And again, we're going to have to follow drug levels. Again, this can cause a loss of IQ points over time. It has a general sedating effect, which mitigates somewhat over time as they get used to the drug, but be careful to warn the parents that for the next week or two, their child may be excessively sleepy. Ethosuximide is our first-line anti-seizure medicine for children with absence seizures. So I threw it in here as an alternative example of a seizure medication you'll see children being on. The side effects of ethosuximide are drowsiness, behavioral changes, nausea, and they can get an aplastic anemia or a lupus-like syndrome. The general principle here is there are lots of drugs we use in children. We need to know what the side effects are, and we need to know which drugs are most effective in which seizure syndromes. It's really a matter of what's the side effect profile, what are your monitoring needs, and what's the seizure type. Let's switch goals into focal seizures. Now remember, only children with focal seizures are going to have auras warning them of an impending seizure. Auras are a unique thing for each child. Sometimes they'll see certain colors or just get a sense that a seizure is coming on. Focal seizures usually affect one area of the body, let's say an arm or a face. The child may be fully awake during the event. We diagnose it with EEG, but an MRI is absolutely indicated in a child with a first-time focal seizure because we need to rule out a focal abnormality in the brain. We're going to treat focal seizures with AEDs, implanted devices, in bad cases, ketogenic diet, or surgical removal of the lesion or the area that's seizing. Infantile spasms are a severe and very sad disease that happens to infants and can have a terrible prognosis. These look really unique. And I would urge you to get online, go to YouTube, and find a video of infantile spasms. They're all over the place. It's important to be able to recognize them because diagnostically, it's important to make this diagnosis. These children have generalized myoclonic jerks of the neck, trunk, and limbs. It generally begins between 3 and 7 months of age. The specific etiology of the majority are unknown, or they're genetic or syndromic. Children who are not actively seizing will typically start off with having a normal neurologic exam, and the typical EEG finding is something called hypsarrhythmia. You should probably remember that. That might show up on a test. Infantile spasms have a very bad diagnosis, and it's a very bad prognosis. The death occurs in about a third within 3 years of diagnosis. These children have profound cognitive effects from their recurrent seizures. The seizures are profoundly hard to control, and in survivors, they gradually turn into other types of seizures, which can persist into adulthood. Another type of seizure that's much less concerning is benign rolandic epilepsy. This is also called benign epilepsy with centrotemporal spikes, or BECTS. That's because these patients tend to have centrotemporal spikes on their EEG. These present as simple partial seizures, usually in the face and the hand. It begins a little bit older, between 5 and 12 years of age, and usually in normal children who are developing normally. What's key is they usually occur during sleep, or within an hour of falling asleep. Almost all are outgrown during adolescence. They have those specific EEG findings, and treatment is optional because they're asleep while they're having the problem.